In the second part of this lecture on binaural technology, I would first like to recapitulate the framework that we have considered so far. The spatial properties of sound sources, that is, their position in space and the properties of the surrounding environment, are encoded in binaural room impulse responses. These describe the acoustical transfer path from a source point in space to a reference point in the human ear canal. These transfer functions can be measured with a loudspeaker and a binaural receiver in real environments. They can also be numerically simulated by room acoustical simulation and by convolving each individual sound reflection with the HRTF of the corresponding direction of sound incidence. If it is now our ambition to simulate an acoustical event as it would be in reality, say a string quartet playing on stage in a concert hall, there is one important shortcoming in this framework. In reality, the string quartet would remain on stage no matter if I move my head to the left or to the right. In the simulation, however, the complete acoustical scene would move along with me. You can nicely compare this to the visual equivalent when you have a head-mounted display on your head that, similar to the binaural case, provides an image to the left and the right eye. When you look at a conventional video, this image would just move with you when you turn your head. With a true virtual reality implementation, however, you could turn your head in the virtual environment, and all objects would stay where they are. This difference is crucial for the perceived presence in a virtual environment, and just like in the visual case, it requires that your head movements are tracked by the system and that the signals at the ears are recalculated whenever you change your head orientation. In binaural technology, this requires that the binaural impulse responses of a sound source have to be measured or simulated for different head orientations, and that these have to be stored in a database, that the head movements are tracked with a head tracking system, and that the binaural room impulse responses have to be exchanged in real time while the source signal is convolved. This is the difference between static and dynamic binaural synthesis. The latter does not only improve our sense of presence in the environment, it also provides a much more precise localization of sound sources in this environment. This can be demonstrated with the results of a listening test, which was conducted once with static and once with dynamic binaural synthesis. Stimuli were presented at a certain azimuth angle, for example, in front or behind or at the side of the listener. And on the y-axis, you see where the listeners localized them. You can, for example, see that sources in front were sometimes correctly localized in front, but sometimes at the back. That sources presented at 30 degrees were sometimes correctly localized at 30 degrees and sometimes falsely at 150 degrees. And sources presented at the back were sometimes correctly localized at the back, but sometimes also at 0 degrees in front. All in all, you have a localization pattern that can be described by two cones which indicate front-back confusions. These front-back confusions are due to the fact that both directions produce about the same interaural time and level differences. And since ITDs and ILDs are the most important cues for localization, this will result in a perceived ambiguity of localization. When you listen to the video again that I showed in the first part with closed eyes, with me talking in the anechoic chamber in front of a dummy head, producing a static binaural signal, you can try to focus on exactly this phenomenon. This ambiguity does not appear in natural listening, because when I turn my head to the left, the signal of a sound source in front will arrive earlier and louder at the right ear, whereas it will be earlier and louder at the left ear for a source at the back. So if I manage to adapt the ear signals to these movements also in binaural synthesis, this confusion will be immediately resolved as well. This was verified by the same listening test. In the dynamic case, when the sound field is correctly adapted to the head orientation of the listener, the front-back confusions disappear, and the localization performance in general is more accurate. With dynamic binaural synthesis, of course, the framework of binaural technology gets a little more complex, and two immediate questions arise. First, how fast the system must react to the new head orientation, and second, how fine the spatial resolution of binaural room impulse responses has to be in order to provide a stable sound image and smooth transitions when the impulse responses are exchanged. The first question aims at the latency of a dynamic system. What happens if the exchange of binaural impulse responses takes too long? This is illustrated by the picture that you see. Well, until the exchange takes place, a sound source in front will move along with my head, and only after the exchange has happened, it will jump back to the original position. The latency of binaural systems can have several technical causes, from the head tracking system itself with its latency and update rate, to the processing latency of the fast convolution algorithm, to the reproduction latency of the audio playback and the sound card. If you summarize all these contributions as system latency and measure in a listening test, at what point listeners start to notice this in a dynamic binaural simulation, you get the following curve. It shows the detection rate measured in a three alternative forced choice experiment. And you can see that at a latency of 50 milliseconds, the subjects start to notice artifacts due to latency. And that at 200 milliseconds, the latency can always be easily identified. So with acoustic virtual reality, we are considerably more tolerant towards latencies than with head-mounted displays, for example, where already latencies above 20 milliseconds are noticeable and can even lead to the so-called simulator sickness, because the visual information does not correspond anymore to the information of the vestibular system. The second question aims at the spatial resolution of binaural impulse response databases. To allow for an unrestricted movement of the head, they have to be acquired for all possible orientations of the head towards the sound source. Remember this picture of different head and torso simulators, which I showed you in the first part. One of them, the one at the right side, is equipped with a robotic neck joint so that it can turn his head into every direction and measure complete data sets of binaural impulse responses in an automatic procedure. For this procedure, a sampling grid of horizontal and vertical head orientations has to be defined, and this defines the spatial resolution. For example, for HRTF datasets, as a special case of binaural impulse responses, several of such databases have been measured and some are even publicly available in the internet. For example, for an equiangular grid with 2 degrees resolution, horizontally and vertically, you would need 180 times 90 and thus more than 16,000 measurements. On the other side, if you want to adapt the virtual sound field only to horizontal head movements within, say, plus minus 70 degrees, which is typical for a seated listener, 71 measurements will be enough. If the sampling grid is too coarse, the same effect will be experienced as with high latency, that the source will first move with your head and then jump back to the original position when the next grid point is reached. How high the resolution has to be in order to avoid audible artifacts can be tested in a listening test, where we have evaluated the required resolution for horizontal, vertical, and lateral head movements. The results show the just noticeable resolution of a data set of binaural room impulse responses as a distribution of all subjects involved with the median, the interquartile range, and the extreme values. You can see that it makes little difference whether these data sets are recorded in an anechoic or in a reverberant environment, and that it also makes little difference whether the sound field is adapted to horizontal or to vertical head movements. Both distributions show just noticeable resolutions between 2 degrees for the most sensitive subjects and 10 degrees for less demanding listeners. The values for lateral head movements at the right seem quite large, but this is only true because the sound source was in front at this experiment, where it makes little difference whether you tilt your head to the side a little or not. If the source, on the other hand, is placed above the listener, the tilting will affect the interaural time delay and you can expect a much higher sensitivity. So we did the test again in a second experiment where we obtained the same distribution with values between 2 and 10 degrees, also for lateral head movements if the source is placed above the listener. So to summarize this, we could say that a grid of binaural room impulse responses should have a resolution of about 2 degrees when you want to make sure that the discretization of the virtual acoustic environment stays inaudible even for experienced and attentive listeners. As you have seen, many details have to be considered for a state-of-the-art implementation of binaural synthesis, and I have picked only some examples of a much longer list of challenges. To conclude this lecture, we could ask how successful binaural synthesis can be implemented after all. As the ultimate aim, we can regard a perceptually authentic simulation of the ear signals. That is, one that cannot be discriminated from the corresponding real sound field, even by direct comparison. This can be tested with a setup like this, where you have 2 loudspeakers, one in front, one at the side. They act as real sound sources, and you have a dynamic binaural simulation of these 2 loudspeakers, which are reproduced over headphones. The binaural impulse responses were measured with microphones in the subject's own ears for different head orientations, and the binaural signal was played with a headphone which was particularly designed for tests like this because with its extra aural design, so a headphone that is more like a loudspeaker some centimeters in front of the ear, the sound field of an external source will not be obstructed even if you wear the headphones all the time. Listeners have now tried to discriminate the real loudspeaker from the simulated loudspeaker in an ABX listening test, where they are confronted with the real loudspeaker, A, with a simulation, B, and with a third stimulus, X, for which they have to decide whether it sounds more like A or B. So the guessing rate for tests like this is 50%. And only with a significantly higher detection rate, we can assume that the difference was indeed identified. In this test, the threshold of significance was 75%. And as you can see, with pulsed pink noise as a stimulus, the subjects were almost always able to hear the difference. This does not mean that they were able to identify which of the two stimuli was the real source and which was the simulation. But still, in direct comparison, there was an audible difference. With speech as a stimulus, on the other hand, only half of the subjects were able to discriminate the two stimuli. So, with a much more narrow frequency range of speech compared to pink noise, there were obviously not enough spectral cues to make this difference reliably audible. If we now summarize the second part of this lecture, we can recapitulate that dynamic binaural synthesis aims at creating virtual acoustic environments by reconstructing the sound pressure in the human ear canal and account for head movements of the listener. This is reached by convolving anechoic source signals with binaural room impulse responses. And these are taken from a database that accounts for different head orientations to the source and selected based on head tracking of the listener. This database should have a spatial resolution of about 2 degrees in every degree of freedom of head movement, which the simulation wants to account for. And the exchange of impulse responses should have a system latency below 50 milliseconds. And with respect to the quality of such a system, we can say that with a state-of-the-art implementation, binaural synthesis can be perceptually authentic with inaudible differences compared to reality, at least for non-critical audio content. However, the signals that we encounter in reality are mostly non-critical because there is not so much pink noise in our natural environment. The fact that for critical stimuli differences are still audible, of course, points to remaining inaccuracies. These still include the fact that it is difficult to perfectly compensate the headphone transfer function, resulting in timbre distortions and a loss of spectral cues. And a second challenge still lies in dealing with the individuality of binaural impulse responses. And this is currently one of the most active fields of research in virtual acoustics. So there are still challenges waiting for you.